It's not propaganda.
Why can't you spend time with your football friends? They were nice boys. Since you've joined this, got into this new crowd, I don't recognize you anymore.
Oh yeah, here we go again. It's not propaganda, it's real life. Our people are being killed by these Western kafirs.
Western kafirs, we have no respect for our religion. Islam says that we should all respect each other, believers and non-believers. When I first came to this country, do you know what we had to do? Do you know what we had to go through just to put food on the table? White people back then only saw the color of your skin. We were considered second-class citizens. But we fought the oppression and the racism and made a life for ourselves. By the time I was your age, I had a job, a home, and a future. I worked hard in this country to pay my taxes and to contribute in a positive way. And what are you doing? Wasting your time.
Wasting my time?
All you want to do is blame everything that's gone wrong in your world on someone else. Take responsibility for yourself. Be a man.
I am being a man. I'm here standing up for what I believe in. I'm here fighting the oppression our people are suffering all over the world every day. What are you doing?
I'm trying to raise a son so that one day he will make a difference.
Explain the motivation behind it.
That's a difficult one. For a few years I've been making films tackling and dealing with social issues, like gun crime, bullying, and extremism came on my radar. I was working for Greenwich Council, and they had an issue with people being radicalised within the borough, and they asked if I had any material that they could use that could perhaps steer people away, and had to think about it, and wrote this piece, which I thought could be quite powerful. And I've been doing stuff, going to schools and talking to young people about these issues, so it was something that was quite close to me. So I wrote the script and presented it to them, and they loved it. And it took off from there.
And in terms of the vision behind how the story was told, how did that come about?
I've been doing some research with Greenwich Council into extremism, both fundamental radicalization, as well as national kind of BNP kind of prejudice. And I've spoken to a couple of people who've been involved in, who've been radicalized and who've been victims. And through speaking, through the research, we were able to kind of just build a story and look at the characters and look at the motivations behind the reasons why they got into these gangs and into these gangs and how they got out of them and what were the causes and effects. So with all of that, put it together and just came up with the scripts, showed it to a number of people and got them to look at it and see whether it was credible. And it just grew from there.
How long did it take you to write the script?
About 6 months. Research, write, change, research, write, change, repeat the same kind of process.
And the casting?
The casting, oh god, we only had enough money for 2 days casting, so we had to squeeze a load of casting in. And it was quite interesting because there were two characters, or one of them's here, Louis, when we casted the narrator. We actually found somebody, and he pulled out, he couldn't do it. And then on the last day, we sent out this call, and we had 3 people turn up for his part. The first 2 were terrible. I mean, they were so bad. And it was like 11th hour, we're thinking, this just isn't going to work, we can't afford any more casting. And then Louis turns up in his big jacket, and his boots up to there, and his tight jeans, and he's like, yeah, he's casting. He just smashed it. Absolutely smashed it. We're all watching that. I've got to say, it was this is Ray. Ray, somebody I've worked with for years, wrote, I said, Ray, I've got this idea for a film and I need some poetry in there. Could you write it? So we spoke about what it should sound like and what we felt the piece should portray. And he wrote this stuff and then I sent it to him and he just said, yeah, got it. And he delivered it on point every single time. And I remember that time on set where we had to change some of the lines. And we were halfway through the day and there were some changes and I had to change like maybe half a page of dialogue. And I said, look, Lou, we've got this stuff and you've not had a chance to rehearse it. Can you do it? He's like, yeah, got it back. On point every time. So yeah, well done.
What's it like to hear those compliments?
Flattered. I wasn't getting those compliments on set. No, it was good. Like, working with all these guys was just amazing. And to be honest, I didn't really expect it, just because I kind of got a call the day before, you know, this casting, so I went to it. But meeting all these guys and working with them was unbelievable. And just the writing as well, the poetry to it was just incredible. Yeah.
Are you an actor that takes any job or specific kind of jobs when kind of work on a project like this one?
Yeah, I definitely don't take any job. You know, it's with all of us actors who are starting out and trying to get somewhere. I could see from the get-go that this was going to be something great from just reading the script and the audition and speaking to Wayne in general, that it was going to be something special and something deep and meaningful. And that's kind of stuff I like to do, yeah.
And what's it like to play a character who's kind of behind the scenes, kind of the god, kind of overseeing everything else?
Yeah, it was interesting, because you usually don't play a character who's the kind of the ghostly figure. Do you know what I mean? You're usually in, like one of these guys, you're in their shoes and you're full of all these emotions, but I had to kind of stay on the outside looking in. But it was great, because I got to kind of be on both sides of the table. You know, on your side and your side. So it was interesting. It was definitely, I feel like it's made me a better actor. Yeah.
What did you work on before this? Was it your first film?
No, it was my first film with Wayne though. So that was an experience.
Can you elaborate on that?
No, you know, he's the calmest guy ever. Like, everyone, the thing we're going right on set, some people were panicking. We had a great AD called Dan, who can't be here today, but round of applause for Dan. And we moved pretty fast through it. I think we only did two or three takes through the whole thing. So it was pretty fast paced. But yeah, it's really, really interesting experience. Even from the casting, I think, like you said, we got the call and then we got the job and then I think we started the week later.
And what's it like watching yourself on the big screen?
Yeah, it's interesting. I've been to the cinema before as well growing up, so it's a pretty cool experience.
And I'm going to ask you, so how long ago did you actually make this film, Wayne? How long ago?
I think it was about 2 years.
The film was, we finished, when did we, sorry, when did we finish?
it was two summers ago.
Last year.
Last year.
Complications.
Yeah, the film was made in two. We started the film beginning of last year, and it was a project which was half funded, and then halfway through, funding dried up, so we stopped for 5 months, I think, thereabouts, and then we were waiting for the green light, and then when we got the green light, got everyone back together again, told Ashraf, you need to cut your hair, and we were able to pick it up, and then we finished, I would say, October, November, and then the editing took us into the new year, so it got finished this year, so yeah.
What's it like watching yourself on the big screen?
I mean, it's cool. It's cool to see, but it's also, you know, you can just see everything, and you're just like, ah. I mean, you can't stop just, like, recording what it was like filming it, and being like, this is when we did that take, or this is when we did that, and sort of piecing it together that way.
But it is really cool to see like all the sort of different shots that were taken and to see like elements of those like really out on the big screen.
Is it what you expected?
Expected?
Is it what you expected in terms of?
I guess so. I mean, I feel like we shot like loads of really cool shots, so it's cool to see like, you know, some of them only appear for like a second or something, and it's like, oh yeah, that looks great. But I think
the sort of because he was on very briefly.
Yes, he was. I think the music is really cool. Like the music takes it to a new level that you don't experience when you're filming it.
What's it like to play that role?
Well, I just played it like a father would, you know. So I took all the politics aside, and I thought, well, if it was my son, how would I feel if he was going astray? And so I tried to bring out concern and worry, and you know, rely on father myself. So I can imagine if my son was going down that route, how would I feel? How would I be angry, upset, sad, that sort of thing? So I tried to put the politics aside of the film, just focused on being a dad, really, in the film, and seeing his son possibly go down the wrong way, and being concerned and upset and angry and that sort of thing. So I just played the role of a dad.
So when it came to the lines, obviously Wayne wrote everything. Did you have input in some of the dialogue?
Well, I did feel that I wasn't allowed to improvise. because it's a sort of role where you could sort of let yourself go free a little bit, and, you know. But because the lines had to rhyme a little bit, you know, I felt slightly constricted because I had to sort of stick to the lines. Whereas if they weren't in a rhyming form or a poetic form, as it was, I would have loved to have improvised a little bit and sort of let myself loose and say a few things, which I couldn't. So, but I must say this, I'm really, really grateful that I got to work with Wayne, because I think he's a very slick director. And someone said earlier that he's so laid back that when you're filming and you've done the shot, you don't realize that you've put in all this hard work, because it looks quite easy and very laid back, and very, you know, the atmosphere on the set was very, very relaxed.
Right, we'll move on to the poet at the very end.
Ray Ray.
Shall I call you Ray Ray or just Ray?
I think Ray will be just fine.
Does poetry come natural to you?
As someone that grew up listening to hip hop, yes, it certainly does. So for me, it's just like just taking the beat away.
I haven't been upset yet.
What? Now, Daddy, you did a good job. Yeah, so it is very natural for me. Yes.
How was it like working with Wayne?
Very good, very good. I was just up here reflecting how long I've known Wayne, and it's gone into that 10-year mark now. And you know, one of the comments that was just made is that he's very slick, you know, producer, director, or what have you. And I remember seeing one of his short films at this time. He was about to shoot one of my pieces, and I remember seeing it and thinking, my goodness, this guy is off the chain. You're asking me to work with you? No. I'll work with you. It's not a problem at all. So, you know, very good, very, very creative. And he makes my job when he wants me to have creative input as well very easy, because, you know, I can just feel the creativity jumping off the page.
Is there a reason why we don't see a lot more spoken word on screen? Because it seems like there's a stigma in terms of why it's not in more dramas, why it's not in more TV programs, films. Can you put your finger on as to why we're not seeing more of this?
Okay, I'll speak from a personal perspective in terms of sometimes how poetry can be viewed. It can sometimes be viewed as, you know, eerie, fairy, pie in the sky. That sounded really, really nice, but in reality, what does that actually mean? Yeah. Whereas I think spoken word is a lot more of a social narrative. If you ever go to a spoken word slam or event, you'll hear poets speaking about what's current and what's actually real, and you know, people are connecting with that. So I think it's certainly growing as an art form. It has a long, long way to go. But you know, you see people like, you know, George the Poet being involved in the opening ceremony of 2012. I was like, wow, you know, well done you. That certainly doesn't happen every day for spoken word artists. So just, you know, going back to your question, can I put my finger on it? Not really. I guess it's just exposure. But as I said, you know, when it's been exposed on a global scale such as that, then hopefully the future looks bright for spoken word.
Now, Wayne, we spoke earlier in the week when we were doing the screen test and everything, and I said to you, why is it so short? So why is it so short?
It was,
initially, the film was, it was supposed to be shown in schools, initially. That was the reason why the film came about. And we needed a piece that could fit into a lesson. So we wrote it for... The initial idea was actually not a speech length, so there was a lot more to it, but we had to condense it down. So there are bits in the film which I think may have been a bit rushed or, you know, quite condensed. I would love to revisit the feature version of it. I mean, I think it's something that's definitely needed and would work really, really well out there now. I haven't seen much anything like it. And with the poetry in there as well, it gives it a unique twist, makes it slightly different. And the question you asked before about why you don't think there's any poetry is a bit risky. You know, but if it's done well, it can be amazing. You know, so I think with working with the right crew, in Ray did an amazing job writing Lewis's parts, and Lewis did a great job delivering those lines. So it works, but I don't think there are a lot of people who want to take a risk on something which is uncharted like that. So what would your advice be to writers, directors, creatives who feel like they can't take the risk, they're just risk averse because it's not going to get accepted, it's not going to get commissioned? Well, if we don't try at least to take a risk, and we don't do anything, we don't get anything done. So you have to. There is in this game, there is no place for people who don't want to push the boundaries, try to be different, try to be creative. Creativity is all about risk, so one goes hand in hand with the other. When we did this, and I remember speaking to the client about the idea. So he got this idea about two guys, one's Muslim, one's white British, and they get caught up in extremism. And they're like, great, great, great. The twist is, we want to deliver it with poetry, we want to use spoken word, oh, and we want to have this kind of omnipresent person in the background. And they're like, hey, trust me, it's really going to be amazing. You know, and it's about being able to, on one hand, you have to be a salesman, you have to be able to sell your idea. If you can get people to buy into your vision and get them to trust and believe that you know what you're doing and that you're going to do an amazing job and that, well, that their money's safe in your hands, then, you know, that's half the job. So, with me, it was all about, if I'm going to do this, it has to be different, it has to be spectacular, it has to be amazing. As amazing as I can make it, given the tools I've got to work with. And my tools were amazing, they were great. We worked together so well on set, and everything I asked of them on the day, they delivered, so, you know.
I really enjoyed actually watching the film. But what I want to ask is, what now for this particular film? I do feel that it should be shown on a wider platform. It does have a different sort of messages, and I think, you know, it should go further. So what now for this film?
The story of the film was initially commissioned to go into schools to be shown as part of citizenship. Change of government, change of policy. They don't like the film no more.
So, as it stands, it's a film with an affix above. So, I would love to get it out there. I'd love for it to be seen or in festivals, on TV. Kids, it was initially put together so that kids could understand. And the version for schools was slightly different. It had pulse points in it. What should Bilal do now? What should Patrick do now? And stuff like that, which has all been taken out. But I think that a project like this, and of this nature, does need to be seen. If anyone has any suggestions, please let me know. But we are trying to actively get it out there and get more people to see it. So we're trying.
You've come a long way. It's great to see the development in your skills. It's very interesting the formula you come up with the fourth wall narration, which worked beautifully with Mosaic's poetry. I haven't seen you in years, Mosaic. It's an amazing formula, and I think it could be taken further, and it should be taken further. The characters were quite strong, and this is a story and stories which still continue to play out in real life, as we saw in the first film, which had many dimensions of these elements of Islamophobia and extremism, which is very current now. And I think, you know, as much as it may seem like a short film, it could be, you know, actually developed into a series of maybe a ten-part series. What do you think about that?
It still amazes me that this subject of extremism is something which is at the forefront. I mean, every day in the news there's a story which is dealing with this. So I'm surprised that there is not much more, that there isn't more stuff like this out there. Not just in schools, but, you know, as educational pieces. I mean, I learned a hell of a lot making this. I mean, I learned so much. And as a group of actors and crew, on set, I spoke at length to the actors about what the project meant, not just to me, but what it meant, and if it got into school, what it could mean nationally. And, you know, I took a lot of pride in the fact that it was something that could end up in schools, that my kids and your kids could end up seeing this and hopefully learning something from it. So there definitely does need to be more stuff like this out there. I'm actually trying to, I'd love to do the feature of this.
Hi, I'm here at Buff, and I'm here to support Wayne Campbell and Dominic Taylor.
Hi, my name's Wayne Campbell. I'm the writer, director, producer of Questionable Prejudice. Questionable Prejudice is a film about extremist behaviour in the inner cities. The project came about a couple of years ago. I had an idea to make a film about the growing layer of people getting involved in extremist groups, be it Islamic fundamentalism or right-wing groups. It was a lot of fun to make the film. We learned a lot of lessons. The actors brought their A games, and I think we put on an amazing, I put together an amazing piece of work, which when you watch, I'm sure you'll agree.
Good evening. My name is Suresh, Sippy. I have an involvement with a film called An Unquestionable Prejudice. I play the role of one of the leading characters called Bilal. So I play Bilal's father. And really, I'm very excited that this film has come to Camden and there are so many people about watching this film, because I thought it was a lovely, lovely story. And I think very relevant in today's times when people are talking about radicalization, etc., etc. All I want to say is that when I played the role of Bilal's father, as a father, I didn't care about, and I think that applies to most fathers, they're not interested in terrorism or color or caste or religion. I think as a father, my main concern was my son's safety. And I think that's what comes across in the film. So I think this film conveys very well that most parents are really mainly concerned about their sons' or their children's safety. And I think if all parents did that, I think we could live in a peaceful society. That's my take on it. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Ashraf, and I play Bilal in Questionable Prejudice. It's a role, it's about a boy who starts getting influenced by the wrong people. And it was a great role to take on, and you know, to try and do something with a very sort of humane side of it, and to really understand why someone would start to go down a certain route rather than judge them.
Hi, my name's Eddy Elsey. I played Patrick in Questionable Prejudice.
I'm Louis Chandler Joseph. I played the narrator.
Questionable Prejudice is a film highlighting the kind of racial extremism and how easy it is to fall into that as a young child with no role models or the wrong role models. And yeah, it was a really, really good experience. The film directed by Wayne Campbell, really, really slick.
Wicked, wicked. I think today to be at Buff, having it shown on a big screen was like an honour. Amazing festival, amazing chance to basically get our work out there. So it was great, it was great.